I can imagine that most of you have heard a horror story or two about Halloween candies being tampered with. Well, for this Halloween-themed episode, we're going to be looking into a despicable case that occurred in the United States. On the 31st of October 1974, Ronald Clark O'Brien was out trick-or-treating with his two children, Timothy, who was 8, and Elizabeth, who was 5. Their neighbour Jim Bates had come along with his son too. Ronald lived in Deer Park, Texas, with his wife and two children. Ronald had a decent job as an optician, earning a modest wage. But despite this, he was in some pretty bad debt. As a response to this, Ronald increased his children's life insurance policies. If a tragic event was to occur to one of his children, he would receive a $40,000 payout each. While the family were out enjoying the festivities, they came across a house that appeared to be vacant. The children, of course, saw every house as an opportunity, so they approached and knocked on the door, eagerly awaiting some more Halloween treats. But after waiting for some time, nobody answered the door. With plenty more houses to go to, they decided to give up and move on. But Ronald didn't. He stayed behind and waited for the door to open a little longer, while the rest left and went to the next house. All of a sudden, Ronald came up from behind holding 5 21-inch pixie sticks. He told the group that somebody from the house that seemed empty had come out and handed the candy to him. Ronald distributed the pixie sticks to Timothy, Elizabeth, and Jim's son, and gave another one to Jim to give to his other child that had decided to stay home. The last pixie stick tube was given to another neighborhood child that they came across on their way home. Ronald knew the boy and his family from church. When Ronald got home with Timothy and Elizabeth, he told them they were both allowed to eat one piece of candy before going to bed. Elizabeth chose her candy, and Timothy chose his. Timothy had chosen the pixie stick that his father had given to him. Timothy opened up the tube, but the consistency was unusual. The powder inside was all stuck together. Ronald came to assist Timothy. He held the pixie stick in between his hands and rolled it around to unstick the powder inside and to break it up. With the powder inside loosened up, Ronald poured it directly into Timothy's mouth. Upon tasting the powdered candy, Timothy remarked that it tasted rather strange. Undeterred, Ronald continued to give him the powder from inside the pixie stick. To wash down the strange-tasting candy, he grabbed his son a glass of Kool-Aid. Very shortly after consuming this strange confectionery, Timothy began vomiting and convulsing. Terrified, the parents called the emergency services. By the time the paramedics arrived, Timothy was convulsing on the floor. He was quickly rushed to hospital. On the way to the hospital, Timothy tragically passed away. This had all happened within the hour of him eating the candy. An autopsy was soon carried out on his body, and a shocking discovery was uncovered. Timothy had somehow ingested a large quantity of cyanide. Panic ensued in the community. Every parent was deeply worried that their child too could have been poisoned. All of the confectionery in the community was taken to the police and tested for any sinister compounds that could be fatal if consumed. Thankfully, all of these sweets that were tested came back absolutely fine, apart from 5 samples. The 5 pixie sticks that Ronald said he had gotten from the house that night. But of course, the other pixie sticks had been given to other people that night too. Thankfully, none of the other children had eaten the tampered candy. The police questioned Ronald that night and asked him where he had gotten the candy from. That Halloween night had been particularly rainy, so the group only walked down a couple of streets. Despite this, Ronald told the police that he couldn't recall where the specific location of the house was. He also said that the person who handed him the pixie sticks didn't fully open the door. He claimed that a hand appeared through a crack in the door and handed them to him. After such a strange encounter, you'd think that the location of the house would be lodged in his memory. The police, of course, suspected that Ronald was lying. The police escorted Ronald down the route they had walked that night, in hopes it would help him to remember the house. Eventually, his memory had miraculously come back. He showed the police where the poisoned candy had come from. The investigators spoke with the owners of the home, and they revealed that the house was empty all evening, with no one at the home to give out any candy. And they were able to prove without a shadow of a doubt that they were telling the truth. The man who owned the house worked at an airport as an air traffic controller. His shift had not finished until early midnight that night, hours after Timothy had already passed away. The police were now fairly certain that Ronald could have had a sinister part to play in this. And as they began to investigate further, they discovered about the $100,000 debt he was in. And then, they discovered about the life insurance policies that had been taken out on both of his children. And his wife didn't even have a clue about these policies at all. Something was obviously very fishy. I can't even begin to imagine just how awful it must be to lose a child, but I know enough that I'd be struck with grief for some time. The last thing you'd expect is for a parent to cash out a life insurance policy the day after their child passes away, but that's exactly what Ronald did. On the day of Timothy's funeral, Ronald had sparked up conversations with those who had attended. He told them that he was planning on going on a long holiday with the money from the insurance policy. And if all this suspicious behaviour wasn't enough, another piece of damning evidence would soon come to the fore. More investigations revealed that Ronald had tried to purchase cyanide at his place of work in the past. All attempts to buy it had failed. And then, a salesman at a nearby chemical store remembered Ronald coming into the store and inquiring as to where he could purchase the poison. This interaction at the chemical store had occurred just before Halloween. And then, a few people who knew Ronald came forward. They claimed that in the months before the poisoning, he had been asking some questions about cyanide, where to buy it, and how much of it would need to be ingested for it to be fatal. The police were now fairly certain that they knew who the perpetrator was. Ronald was charged with the poisoning, and the trial would soon begin. The media reported on the case, and dubbed Ronald as the Candyman. Throughout the trial, Ronald was adamant that he was innocent, and maintained the story that a mysterious hand had handed him the tampered pixie sticks. There was just too much circumstantial evidence that pointed to Ronald. On the 3rd of June 1975, he was found guilty of poisoning his very own son and attempting to poison his daughter, and his neighbour's sons too. For this despicable and selfish crime, he was sentenced to death, and his wife swiftly divorced him. March 31st, 1984 was the day of his execution, and in the 9 years in between, Ronald never stopped maintaining his innocence and saying that he thought the death penalty was wrong. The execution of Ronald attracted a large crowd of anti-death penalty protesters, and in a strange and almost theatrical response to this, those who were pleased with the fate of Ronald threw candy at the anti-death penalty protesters, and shouted the phrase, "Trick or treat." Ronald gave a final statement and said, "God bless you all, and may God's best blessings be always yours. I forgive all, and I do mean all, those who have been involved in my death." Since the event, Halloween safety has been taken more seriously, and a campaign was launched to teach parents how to inspect candy properly before giving it to their children. The event inspired many urban legends and hoaxes about the tampering of Halloween sweets. There are numerous stories about razor blades and all manner of things found in candies, and it's not always clear if these stories are true. Thankfully, the tampering of sweets is rare, although I guess you can't always be too careful these days.